And welcome everybody to our webinar. Thank you for joining us today. I'm Catherine Hsiao. I lead the sales enablement practice here at Oxygen, and I will be your host for today's virtual experience. Just a bit about Oxygen. We help companies drive growth by modernizing sales enablement and workplace education. And we've been designing modern experiential learning programs for years. Of course, now, as many companies are navigating a massive shift into virtual everything, we thought we could share with you today some of our own thoughts on what it takes to create really great learning experiences in our ever-changing workplace. And of course, it wouldn't be an Oxygen experience if we didn't have a way to, for you to choose your own path today. So stay tuned for that. That's going to be coming right up. But before we go there, let me just introduce our speakers. Today we have Alex Dunn, who leads the experience architecture practice of Oxygen. He is a trusted advisor to many stakeholders who are facing that chaos and complexity of transformation in business. And you will hear his point of view about how architecture and having what we would think of as durable blueprints for employee skilling are key to getting business results. So welcome, Alex.
Thank you for having me. Hi, everybody.
And he's joined here by Kelly Eskridge, who leads Oxygen's formidable team of experience designers. She's passionate about experiential learning that connects people personally with what they need to know and do and helps them put new skills into immediate practice. So from corporate universities to onboarding programs to technical soft skills programs, Kelly has worked across many industries. So thanks for joining us, Kelly.
Thank you, Catherine. Hi, everybody.
So just a little housekeeping before we get started. If you have questions anytime during the presentation, please go ahead and type them into the question box. We will be monitoring that. Jennifer is here as well to help us keep track of that. And we will address them as we go along. But as you'll see, this is going to be a little bit more of an interactive experience with us all today. So in the chat, not necessarily in the Q&A, but in the chat, we would love it if you could, let's start off by sharing one of your favorite tips for blended learning. And we would just love to see some of the things that you know just come in here. Send them to panelists or panelists and attendees, but please go ahead and open up that chat window in Zoom and type something in here about one of your tips for blended learning. We'll give you just a minute to type in. I don't see anything coming in. So that's kind of interesting. I wonder if maybe it's too soon to ask for a tip. Ah, there we go. Thank you. Excellent. We're seeing videos and quizzes prior. Mm-hmm. Make sure we understand the learning styles of the participants. Yep, that's great. Awesome. Excellent. Well, keep those. Yeah, go ahead to Alex.
That's a good one, Carolyn. I like that.
Coaching calls. Yep. Oh, these are great.
These are great. Inclusion's really important to us as well, Matthew. Thank you.
Guy, what Excellent. Does P-create mean?
Maybe that was just a typo.
Oh, okay.
I don't know. Create proximity between learners and facilitators. Virtual whiteboarding. Mm-hmm. Yeah, these are great. Excellent. Well, keep those coming. You can always put those types of things in the chat. We would like to go to our next thing as we're hearing these different things. And part of the reason why we're just asking you for your input is we're going to cover different topics today. We're going to jump around a little bit. And we want to make sure that we want to make sure that we have some of your input as well as we go through this. So the next thing we're going to do here is we have these five different areas that we're going to be covering today, but we'd like you to just take a minute to look through some of this. And we're gonna launch a little poll here where you can kind of vote for what would you like to hear about most? And we'll kind of jump to that topic first. And we may cover all five in this webinar, but just in, so that we make sure we have enough time to focus on what is most important to all of you here. Jennifer, if you could go ahead and launch that poll for us so people can take a look here and give us their vote. And I'm just gonna give folks a little bit more music to listen to here while we do that. Cool. So this will be about 30 seconds. Give you all a second. I feel like I want to just groove out to this little tune here.
Looks like everyone has voted.
Excellent. Thank you, Jennifer. Why don't we go ahead and close that and let's see what we've got for results.
Sorry, I have a chat. Cover up the box. So give me one second. Here we go.
Yep, no problem. We've all been there.
Would you like me to show the results?
Please do.
Yeah.
All right. Look at that. How can less content enable more learning? That is so funny because when we were actually going through our deck, we actually predicted that this one would be the winner, and it is. That is so exciting for us to see. So we're gonna cover that one first. We're gonna cover number three. And then I think when we're done with that, we'll go to, so it's 3, 4, 1, 5, and 2. I think that's great. So I guess what we can do here, we'll close that and move over to some discussion about that. That third question, how can less content enable more learning? So we're going to skip over to that. And Alex, are you going to start us off today with some of this discussion?
I can, yeah. Can we look at all of the bullet points
here? Oh yeah, sorry about that.
I don't want to withhold any secrets.
Yes.
So let's pretend by show of hands, who in the last year has been asked to throw a whole bunch of PowerPoint into a virtual experience because everything went online. I imagine a lot of people in this field have had that experience. And one of the things that we have learned is that that doesn't make a good experience. And so one of the things that we have practiced doing and have found that people respond well to is give them all the content ahead of time as pre-reads and emphasize face-to-face conversation in the virtual experience. And adult learners tend to fill in the blanks in their own understanding. And it's really, it's helped drive the learning and the relevancy of the learning when people get to influence the conversation, assuming that they've all done the pre-read. Kelly, what would you add?
I would just build on that, Alex, because it is definitely something that we look for every opportunity in the way that we approach design work. These days, now more than ever, especially given Zoom fatigue and given the importance of learning to businesses, we can't stop learning just because we can't do it all the ways that we're used to doing. But trying to pack a lot of content into the same amount of time that we might in a classroom doesn't work for so many reasons. And honestly, I would argue that it doesn't always work that well in the classroom either. Part of opening up space for people to explore and practice in is about giving them the opportunity to build knowledge before they come in, because FaceTime is always premium time for us. It's a time to practice, a time to validate, a time to learn from your peers and with your peers, as well as in another self-guided kind of way. And we believe that if you put people together for 40 hours of anything in bulk, that it actually doesn't really enhance their learning, that all of that content in a short period of time doesn't lead to retention. It just leads to the fact that they've been presented with a lot of knowledge. and a lot of information. So to the mix, I would add the idea of sequencing learning over time and having less content in each particular learning episode or learning experience so that people do have that time to think, understand, apply, explore, practice, and really begin to integrate before they move on to the next piece of learning. That way the learning really builds a foundation for them, I think.
You know, that's such an interesting thing you bring up, Kelly, because I always feel like it is so hard to not put so much content in an experience. Like we all struggle with that, right? Because we especially like you could be an expert or you could be just somebody who's on the hook to deliver something. And people are like, well, they need to know all these things. So, you know, resisting that, that urge to just put the content everywhere. I mean, how have you adapted to that? Or like, what do you tell yourself as you're designing something?
I actually have a sticky note on my wall that says, don't overstuff, because like so many other people, I want people to know all the things. And yet they can't know all the things at once. Nobody learns effectively that way. And it ends up being frustrating. So part of what I do that I really enjoy and value in the way that Oxygen approaches this kind of thing is to rely on the learning architecture to help me and my design team really understand how to focus, how to triangulate, how to select the content that really is the most relevant. Understanding that helps us to push back or to adjust or to get the right information out of subject matter experts when we need to. And so I'm going to throw it over to you, Alex, to talk a little bit about that, because without architecture, none of this works.
So there's a story we like to tell from a project a while ago. We're trying to create an enterprise learning experience. And we had a workshop. We had a bunch of different stakeholders in the room. We had people from learning and development and the client organization. We had people from HR. We had people who were leaders in the sales force. And we're trying to get clear on what does the learning experience need to do? What are the outcomes that a person going through the experience needs to achieve? And each of the different perspectives in the room had a different point of view. They need to learn this long list of topics. They need to have this long list of capabilities. They need to know the product catalog for our enormous $30 billion company. And it wasn't until a sales manager after lunch, literally in frustration, stood up, slapped a table and said, a new seller going through this program needs to close a deal of any size by month six. It was a 6-month program. And once we had that clear articulation of a goal, an outcome that everybody could agree to, a lot of the stuff that we had thought about putting in the program just fell away because it didn't enable the participant to close a deal of any size in 6 months. And so if you have a very clear outcome at the beginning, it drives out a lot of the stuff that you might otherwise want to put in the experience. That's a huge lever for making sure that it's relevant, that there's less content, more learning. The other thing that I would add is, and this is a bit of a mindset shift I think I've seen in our clients in the last year and a half, is they're starting to understand it's less about giving content to people and more about architecting an experience. Another way to say it would be creating the conditions for learning to emerge. And so it's less about the learning coming from what we give them and more about it emerging within the adults in the experience that we've architected for them. I'll pause there because we'll talk more about architecture later.
Great. I think that's great. We want to make sure we get through all of these different questions. So I think we're going to actually move on to the next one here, which is the question about how do you find the best and most relevant content for a given audience? Such a challenge. And I think it actually for something like this, and you all on the webinar, you can sort of read some of these bullets, but I think one of these challenges tends to be that content can be in so many different places. And I think the main place that it ends up being is inside other people's heads. So maybe we can talk a little bit about that and how you get that relevant content around what somebody needs to know and do. Kelly, you want to take that one?
Yes, I do. Thank you. I have opinions about this for sure. I definitely feel that the most relevant content to help someone be successful in their role, in the work that they're doing every day, comes from people who have done that work successfully in that role every day and have a lot of things to share. And so those things are in their heads and they may not know how to articulate it. Part of the reasons that we as designers end up with too much content is because subject matter experts who have deeply integrated understanding and skills tend to not really know how to articulate them in a way that moves from the general to the specific. And so we get all the specifics. And it's part of our job to really then sort out what are the things that can help people most in their particular situation. Are they onboarding? Are they still in their first year? Is this a new set of skills that everybody's being expected to start to acquire, et cetera, et cetera? All of that drives what the relevant content is, what success looks like for that person at that stage in that role. That's why Alex's example is so great. What do they need to do after 6 months of onboarding? They need to close a deal. Makes things super clear. The reason that we put avoid at the top of our list and included topic lists, matrices, rubrics, et cetera, is because we feel like adults don't learn in clean, clear, matrixed stages. Adults in their job, no matter whether they're one day in role or 10 years into role, don't march smoothly through the boxes and gradations because we all bring our own mix of life experience and work experience and acquired skills to whatever the work is that they're doing. And so there was a comment earlier in chat from Jessica about opening up space to let people practice and to meet them where they are so that they can figure out what's relevant to them. And this, the stuff on this slide is a big piece of that for us. Alex, what would you add to that?
Oh my gosh, I'm kind of jumping with excitement here. So if I can build on that, so we have a process that we do during design called a SME contribution session. That's one of the things that Kelly's actually really especially just amazing at doing. And it's a short facilitated experience with subject matter experts to get out of them the information that we then sift and find is most relevant. And Kelly and I, we've been working together for a long time. Kelly, how many times have you and I come out of a SME contribution session and you just go, you know, it'd be great if we could just get that SME on video mm-hmm. and put that in the experience? Or what if we got the two of them together to have that conversation in the experience in front of participants? And because they've got it, just put them in front of the participants. And it's always really exciting when you find those opportunities because if it's there in somebody else and they can speak about it in a compelling way, my excitement is because of all the times that we've had that moment of recognition that we're not going to take their stuff and put it in something else. Let's just get them in the experience, put them in front of the learners. Yep.
Absolutely. And we actually find that those kinds of moments where people can hear from people in their organization, in their role, in the field, doing the work, that is where all of the concepts and the knowledge that we've offered to them really land, because they can hear about it from people who have credibility. And that's the difference between learning and being told, is finding ways to really anchor oneself to what's being presented so that you can really start to engage with it. I have never met a capability matrix that ever helped anybody make that happen. And so driving learning design from a tool like that, I completely understand the need to evaluate within organizations and the need to find ways to measure emerging capabilities and their development. But I think that driving learning from or to something like that is suboptimal.
Can I, I have one additional question to offer. It's kind of a thought experiment. If you think real quick about a conversation, this is for the participants on the call as well as us. If you think about, have you ever had a conversation that changed the way you do your job? And locate something in your memory. Have you ever seen a capability matrix or a PowerPoint slide that really changed the way you do your job? And so if we can make those human-to-human experiences possible, I loved Carolyn put a note in the chat early on about a blended learning tip, learners as coaches. That's another way that we do it, because it's so much more valuable and relevant, and it's lower to maintain or lower cost to maintain over time, because you don't have to update content. You just bring in the current people in the role or people who recently exited the role because they've got the latest information. And let them give it to the learners.
Thanks. Yeah, I think that's such a great sort of like, as we're talking about where content comes from, that it's in a lot of people's heads, that it can be, you know, peers and other learners, and it can be subject matter experts. You know, I can imagine some people going, well, like, how am I supposed to get all of those people involved? You know, that isn't that a big time commitment for, say, our very busy subject matter experts to already like to add to their burden? What are some thoughts that you have around involving the SMEs, as we like to call them, and making it easy for them to be involved?
It's definitely the goal to make it as easy as possible for SMEs to be involved, because SMEs they're the source of so much of what we do. And my experience certainly has been that when most SMEs understand what business outcomes are attached to a particular learning experience and understand that they have the opportunity to really affect in a positive way how that experience lands for people. And especially when SMEs understand that the reason we're coming to them is because we want to know what it's like in the daily reality of the work, not just what does your manager or what does your leadership think your reality is like, and what do they think you need to learn? And this really, again, goes back to the idea of meeting the audience where they are. So we try to set things up really in a focused way for SMEs around the impact that they will have. And then we make sure that we have focused conversations. So we tend to structure our learning in terms of episodes, discrete episodes that are topic focused in some way, but that build organically. And I think we're going to take a look at an example of some of that at some point during this discussion. And that's all the architecture that drives things. So we use architecture to set up focused SME conversations. We get multiple perspectives in the room, and then we facilitate a conversation towards understanding better what this particular set of ideas, how that plays out in the working world, and what advice would they give people coming into it? What are the common challenges that they see? We can send folks anywhere to click them through process steps. What we're interested in finding out from SMEs is how the process actually works when it shows up in a daily basis. And what are the things that I would need to know if I'm new in my role to navigate that successfully? So I could talk about this a long time. I'm going to hit the pause button here and see where you want to go with this, Alex.
If I could build on that, the one thing I would add is if you're trying to design a learning experience that has sort of enterprise scale or enterprise impact, one of the biggest pitfalls we've seen is the organization itself or the people creating the program don't appreciate how much internal organizational recruiting they need to do to create sort of the community of learning around the program. So, you know, to use an example, a recent client example, you know, the target audience for a learning experience we created were account executives, sort of 10, 15 years in career. And you could treat them as a silo person in a role and give them the experience that they need to fulfill the needs of the role. But in order to create a holistic experience for them and to create the impact and reach the outcomes that we had agreed with the business, more of the roles around them, their managers, adjacent roles, inside sales reps, other folks needed to participate in the program in some way. And so it's almost like if you take your traditional learning and development work stream, and then alongside it, sort of like a layer cake, there's another layer of organizational recruiting and change management to get more of the organization engaged in the process to create the learning. That's how you can really increase the impact that you can create. There's a thing in sort of systems theory where if you really want to create change in a system, you got to target at least two different places in the system. And so as an architect, one of the things I always look to do is what's the role that we're targeting? And then what's the universe of roles around them that we can draw into the experience to extend and sustain the learning over time?
So I think you're saying something real interesting there, Alex, which is, and we have it here, it says role specific journey based, right? But like, you know, when you look at words on a slide and, you know, people could be like, yeah, you know, role based, that makes sense. But there really is something about being role based and thinking about that the audience in those terms, which I think as an architect, it will probably walk through a little bit of that as well. And there's a connection between that and this idea of pursuing concrete observable outcomes. And I think that's also a word that bears some additional discussion because that it's an interesting word. People can say, well, my outcome is that I wanted to just deliver this training. Right? But is it measurable and does it have some sort of business impact, right? So do you want to talk a little bit about that? And let me know if it's time for us to like skip around to one of our, pass the color teal here and do something else.
we have a caution list. We'll get to that later. But I always, I always think like we should put on the caution list, especially if you've been in large organizations or been a creature of large organizations for a long time. When you experience, you might fall into an experience where the intent of the program is really just to tell somebody's manager that they spent the training budget. And it's not really about creating business impact. So I would say that's a suboptimal learning experience opportunity. Or it's an opportunity for a different kind of conversation. So reframe it around, well, what really is the business impact we can create here? That was one of the things I wanted to make sure we touched on. Both check the box training and check the box investment. I would caution people against that.
Great. Well, I think I'm going to take us to our next question here, which is the first question that we asked, which is about the actual different modalities. And I think this is, again, that word outcomes comes back to us again. Why don't we talk about this a little bit? Kelly, why don't you give us a start?
Thanks, Catherine. So one of the things that people might notice about this slide is that the word modalities doesn't appear anywhere on it. And there are reasons for that, because we think that modality is a vehicle for learning, but it is not necessarily, it doesn't necessarily lead from our perspective when we think about really creating a learning experience and what are the things that ought to be blended within it. So we start with architecture, and we've heard a lot about that today and we'll continue to hear a lot about it because the relationship between architecture and design is an absolutely crucial one, in my opinion. Alex and I and our teams work really well together and very closely together. And that's the way that we stay aligned all the way from the first discussion around business outcomes that happens at the stakeholder level, all the way through to an audience member experiencing the learning and then going out and applying it to their jobs. And we've talked a lot about how we need to really think through not just who's the audience role, but also who are those adjacent roles and how can they inform the perspective that we're bringing and help us and the SMEs drive what people really need to learn and what's relevant for them. I said earlier that it was important not to just assume that managers or leadership know what it is that people need. And I think that's a really important point because it's we're all subject to the organizational requirements of wherever we work. And so if we have leadership who are insisting on a particular set of topics or a particular et cetera, it's very understandable to want to go out and drive specifically to that list. But thinking through these things around what's in this blended learning can help accelerate some of those conversations. There's a lot more that we could say about that. It's really related to the outcomes that we pick and the activities we design. But Alex, I'm gonna let you pick up the ball on this. And I definitely would like to spend some time, however we organize it, around this idea of outcomes, both for the business and then for the individual person in role who's experiencing the learning.
Absolutely. I can think of a customer story, a customer example of ours. So if you were to create an e-learning module, common thing might be to put a little bit of a quiz at the end of it for the person to check their own learning. And a lot of times in the sort of the architecture design process, you might stop there. For us, we often, because we look at things holistically, the impact that we're looking for, that the business outcomes we pick, they might show up in performance metrics for the organization. They might also show up, very often do, in the relationship between the person and their manager. Because that's where performance is evaluated on an ongoing basis. And so in addition to maybe putting a quiz into the e-learning module for a person to check their own understanding, what we would often do is also design an activity afterwards, short conversation guide, go have a check-in with your manager. You just completed this huge portion of training, maybe not all of it. Maybe it's just, you know, a season in a year of an experience that we design. But at the end of the season, check in with your manager about the three things you got from the learning experience. And at the same time, we'll provide the manager a conversation guide so they can anticipate that you're going to come to them and they've got some questions to ask. And so what we've done is we've put the measuring of the outcome in the relationship between the target person going through the learning experience and their manager, because that's where their performance is going to be seen. And it also adds a different mix of modality, makes the learning more sticky and more interesting for people. I was thinking of frontline manager, just for Kelly and Catherine's perspective. Yeah. That was one of the places where we did that.
Yep, that is one of the places where we did it. And we have a client story also about thinking through this idea of where the topic list comes from. I remember one particular project with a client where the leadership in the room was absolutely convinced that the role audience needed time management skills, and that the reason they weren't being successful was because they need better time management. And of course, when we talked to people in role, they were managing their time absolutely brilliantly. They had a whole foundation of other challenges that were preventing them from accomplishing all the things that they needed to accomplish. And if we hadn't sort of taken that deeper dive, we wouldn't have understood that. And we wouldn't have been able to go back and facilitate those conversations with leadership around why there was no time management module in the learning experience that we were going to provide for them. So who you architect for really does drive everything in the learning and the outcomes that you pick. And we emphasize business outcomes all the time because we think that individual success should be tied to organizational success. So we define business outcomes for the learning journey, and then we define outcomes for every episode. And we're pretty careful to talk about outcomes rather than learning objectives, because we always want to think about every single design, every single moment that someone is engaged in a learning experience, whether it's self-guided or in a virtual live setting, that we are helping them steer and accelerate towards a particular outcome for themselves that's going to have them show up more successfully and have that impact on the business. So as an actual granular example of that, one of the things that that we do is really look for, when we're talking about outcomes, we look for external action verbs, and we're always driving toward what people need to know and do as a result of this learning. So we'll look for apply versus understand, because we're very activity driven in this way. We'll look for explaining clearly to a customer rather than describe this, because we want to make sure that everything revolves around how the person is going to take the learning and be better in their job. And those outcomes drive these learning episodes or modules. And that's where we get back to relevance of content. If content doesn't support those outcomes, it doesn't belong in the learning experience, or the outcome needs to be adjusted.
So Kelly, I think you have set us up perfectly to take a look at an artifact that we develop as part of our engagements with clients. It's part of that upfront work, which I think somebody else had also mentioned, but like, we will actually create a map. Oop, and I might've just gone to the, sorry about that. Hang on. This one right here. So Alex is gonna walk us through this, because I think it touches on the modalities, the role, the sequence, the content. Like, it basically, this is your sort of all in one view of all of these different concepts that we've been talking about.
Yeah, so this is a great build on what Kelly was describing. There's a lot in this map. This is like a layer cake. We produce these for every project where we do architecture, and this is one of the first deliverables we produce. This represents often maybe half of the architecture process, understanding the scope, clearly identifying what are the business impacts we're looking for in a program, and getting all of the stakeholders aligned on that, making some very clear decisions about the delivery model. Is it going to be online? Is it going to be offline? Is it going to be a mix? Is it going to be solo? Is it going to be cohort-based? Is it going to be e-learning? Is it going to be on-the-job practice? All that kind of stuff. And then we've got a legend in the lower left for the modalities we chose for this particular client experience. And we tend to organize things in sort of a general framework of missions that are driven by a theme. And then within a mission, there are episodes. I think historically episode might've been sort of an e-learning module expression, but we think of it more organically as an episode is a segment of activity where you're doing a particular thing. So a checklist before you start the program, welcome to the program in the jumpstart section might be an e-learning experience, but it's got a mix of video and some other stuff. And then maybe there's some reading material that they have to consume before they move on to the next thing. You can see here at the end of mission 1, 2, and 3, we do have these connect experiences. Go talk to your manager and share what you got from the experience that you just went through. We've also got in this one a nice mix of go connect with other people, with peers in the organization, to have a particular kind of conversation, to learn, you know, X, Y, and Z. And we've designed all of that into the program so that it's not just go have a meet and greet and learn that there's, you know, somebody in another office that you can have coffee with on Zoom, but you're going into that conversation looking for a briefing about a particular thing. How have we gone to market with a partner for the benefit of a customer? And in this particular overall experience, one of the things we're having people do is collect those stories so that when they're done with mission 3, they have internalized their own set of current relevant partner customer stories that they can then use in their day-to-day job.
Yep.
Lots of other stuff to go into.
There's
here,
so much stuff that goes into. Yeah, yes.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah. And I'm going to kind of move us along, because I know we want to get to some of the other questions. Anything else that you want to show? You want to move into the blueprint aspect, or would you like to just tackle the next question?
One thing I want to say about this is, in our architecture process, this is the way we talk about this is we slow down in order to go fast. And so this artifact, the experience map, and the next thing we're going to show you, if you want to switch to it, Catherine, I think the blueprint, this is the double click for the layer cake. And I'll talk about this in a second. These two things we try to do up front in order to specify in as much detail as we can what we then hand off to Kelly and her team to build. And so part of our business value is to give them a spec that is so granular that they can accurately, you know, understand it, see what it is, how big it is, and they know what kind of effort to bring to it, and all that kind of stuff. So really quickly to orient to this, there were a couple of columns for missions 1, 2, and 3 in the Jumpstart in the previous slide. Here we've got the same thing, the four columns on the right. This is, I've got a couple of them on the wall behind me. They're typically, you know, 3 or 4 feet tall and maybe 2 feet wide. And what we're doing here is we're showing the details of each episode, each checklist, each e-learning module, each reflect conversation, each moment, each connect with your manager or with a peer. We give a description, we enumerate the topics that need to be covered, the estimated duration, if there's an office document or some kind of an asset that's got to be made, if it's an e-learning thing, how many minutes is it, all those details. And you can see an example on the left. You know, the Reflect 1 is a solo thing and the eLearn 5 is a module. So you can see the level of detail we put into these in the architecture process so that the design development team knows what they're building. And separating those two steps out, architecture up front, then design development, is we have found to be not only pretty powerful, but it enables the design development to go a lot faster.
Great. Kelly, anything to add?
Yes, this opens up for me just a whole wealth of conversation about the importance of the partnership between architecture and design. Because there are many ways that we work together and many ways that we influence each other. Obviously, Alex and his team influence what the design team works on by providing both the learning map and then this more detailed blueprint. We have the opportunity to influence that because during this handoff process, as this particular deeper level document is being built, we have the opportunity to collaborate and to provide ideas and to start gaining the understanding of the overall shape of the experience that the architect is putting together. And that's enormously useful for us. One of the things that I encounter sometimes that I worried about myself when I first started working this way is that this seems potentially so prescriptive. Where's the creativity for the design team? Are we just taking orders and making pizza here and delivering it out? And the truth is completely opposite to that. Having this kind of detail and being able to collaborate together during the finalization of it allows us as a design team to really understand what we're creating, why we're creating it, to understand the constraints that our client might be under in terms of it has to be a self-guided journey. But look what kinds of things we can put around it in order to support that learning so it's not just click, click, click. Look at the activities that we can develop, et cetera. We take all of that, and when we go into these contribution sessions with SMEs that we've been describing, we are the folks who really unlock what they know that might serve these outcomes in these ways. And what we find out sometimes is that we made assumptions that maybe aren't accurate, or we find that we unlock a vein that didn't come up during the initial discussions. And that's not because architects do a bad job. It's because it's a very layered process. It's an incremental process of understanding, going from here are business outcomes to how do we meet people where they live in ways that are relevant and meaningful for them. So once we as a design team become custodians of the architecture, once we really understand it, which we can only do when we've reviewed it and been exposed to it in this level of detail, once we become its custodians, then we figure out the absolute best way to execute for those people. And that it's the most creative use of my design abilities and skills that I've ever experienced. So I feel like it's important to say, because it can be hard to look at something like this and not feel a little hesitant about it.
I want to applaud you, Kelly, for the work that you and your team do there, because it really is amazing. You know, when we thumbnail out a set of topics like, you know, partner competencies, and you got 2.5 minutes, that's literally thumbnail level detail. But then you go, you and your team go in and do a SME contribution session, and you really find out, okay, what are the key things? It's not all the things. What are the key things that people need to know at this point in their journey about partner competencies? And let's zero in on that and then make a compelling learning experience around it. It's really, it is magical work from my perspective.
I think it's great for all this articulation, and you know, for something like this, which different people may have different types of structural artifacts to do this type of work. We are going to probably skip over the last two questions just in the interest of time, other than to say that I think we can, if you have questions or really we're wanting to know the answer, you can certainly reach out to us. And we're going to just kind of leave you with a few tips here on blended learning. And while you're just kind of reading through, and just before Alex starts, we did have one question in the chat, which was really about sales enablement, which I think is kind of an interesting aspect, because we've talked a lot about designing learning experiences. But one person just wanted to know, well, like, if you're in sales enablement, does this stuff happen in the training group or is it the enablement group? And the answer really is it can happen in both areas. It can get a little tricky with a little bit of friction as to who owns what. But I think that there does have to be a group that puts together this type of deep thinking about what people need to know and do, whether it's sellers, customer service folks, anybody else. And where that part of the organization is, it's kind of where the people are that have the passion to do that on behalf of them. But it's usually pretty matrixed, or it's, you know, different types of handoffs and things. But we've seen both of those things happen. And I guess with that, we're gonna just kind of end with these different tips, and you can read through. But Alex, is there anything you want to say about some of these bullets?
In the interest of time, I think I'll zoom in on number five. These are some things that we see. There's a lot of pressure on learning and development right now, on training, to compress the amount of time, to try and, you know, take literally shortcuts to mastery. I want people to become masters of this thing or be able to coach on it after 45 minutes. And so these are some of the things that we see people doing that we feel some caution about, and it makes us curious. We look a little more deeply. Self-study monolith. You know, take a mountain of PowerPoint, throw it online, and then, you know, pour some gamification special sauce on it. That'll only get you so far. You'll attract the people who are extrinsically motivated, but we want to create the conditions for intrinsic motivation to be brought forward. Kelly, is there anything that stands out here that you'd want to build on or add?
Yes, thanks, Alex. I would probably want to zero in on the final item, that any learning experience, regardless of modality, can and should be interactive and experiential. Modality is just a vehicle. It's not an inhibitor of creating this kind of learning. And that's one of the most important things that I think can be applied to blended learning, or honestly, any kind, any other kind, is the focus on helping people not just receive information, but apply what they're doing in their particular daily round. And every modality is capable of that.
Great. Well, we want to make sure that we give some folks a little bit of time back in the rest of this hour. So I want to thank everybody for your participation, your questions in the chat. You can always track us down. It's very easy. You can find us either on LinkedIn or use connect@oxygenexp.com if you would like to reach us directly, especially if you've had questions that we weren't able to answer thoroughly. I would say here, come join us for the next meeting. I would say, or the next webinar, the Building the Business Case for Learning. And I would say this would be for sales enablement as well. To that question that came through, a lot of times, you know, your most success will be all about the business case that was made to do something. So we're going to talk about that on May 18th. And there is a link to register if you all are interested in doing so. But I think with that, we're going to wrap it up. And thank you very much for attending. And thank you to Kelly and Alex for giving us such a colorful and insightful set of tips.